There's been so much revelation taking place in my spirit from the Lord that's hard to keep up with. Thank God for notebook, paper, pencil, phones where you can make messages and leave messages. We've ministered on angels. We gave it 3 different titles. Angels, can we really trust them? Angels are for real, touched by an angel. Teamwork makes the dream work. The restoration, times and seasons of restoration of all things. Soon, sometime when everyone's back from their vacations, we're going to be talking about eschatology, the rapture of the church, the second coming of Christ. End time things. Looking forward to that. How about you? But all this week, my spirit's been so heavy. And it's like, probably, and I'm weighing my words very carefully, about 90% of what comes out of my mouth this past week, in prayer that is been praying in tongues. Probably about 10% English. And not knowing why, but just praying in tongues, praying in tongues. So I've given birth to a word just for you. You see, as a pastor, I don't come here just to deliver a message or a sermon. And we need messages and we need sermons. But it's like, I feel like a surgeon, a doctor that has come to perform surgery on a person to help them live, to aid them, to support them. And James, the half-brother of Jesus, exhorts us to be not only hearers of the word, but doers of the word. And many times we hear the word, but do not do the word. We're told one thing and we do another thing. And James says, what good is hearing the word if you're not going to do it? If I tell you to do the certain thing and you do the opposite and not practice the word, then the word becomes useless. Obviously, God's word is alive, powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, but we make it useless by our choices. So I pray that we choose life when we hear the word. This is not part of a ceremony Sunday to fill in the gap because this is what I do for a living. And I must give you a little bit of food for today to say I did my pastoral thing. No, folks, this is life. Solomon says, take these words and bind them on your neck and you will live. So today I've come to deliver not just a sermon or a message, but a timely word. I've come to deliver a warning. I've come to deliver an exhortation. But I've come to deliver a word of comfort. Sometimes we need to comfort the afflicted, but sometimes we need to afflict the comforted. And if there's ever been an urgency and an hour to contend for the faith, it's now. So this past Wednesday night in community night, we were sharing. We were concluding with questions and answers that people had. One of the questions that we answered, which was the last question that came in, was why do people shy away from prosperity? And many of us joined in that night and gave answers, and they were incredible answers. But as I was sharing that night, as you were sharing that night, this past Wednesday, the Lord dropped something into my spirit. And that is how we need to contend for the faith and fight the good fight of faith. And I said to everyone that was present on Wednesday night, I said, let's take Wednesday night, next Wednesday, and let's continue on this. But the Lord had a different idea. Because from that night, he birthed something heavy, heavy in my heart for you today. Not knowing the series of events that would take place in people's lives, in churches, in your church, our church, those of you watching your church in America, whether it be Texas or Ohio, or what's going to happen tomorrow, or what's not going to happen. So today I birth the word of the Lord for you. Fighting the good fight of faith. Fighting the good fight of faith. And it's weird because I never shared this before because I've never felt this way before. And that is this. Many times you've heard me say, I'm impregnated. Or you've heard me say, I'm impregnated with twins, like double. You've heard me say that before, and it's quite normal to hear that from me. But today I feel like I'm impregnated with twins. However, I feel like inside of me there's a dead baby. And there's a living baby. And I feel like the dead baby is the one that's saying, according to Isaiah, deep darkness is on this earth. Gross darkness is on the earth. Upon America, upon the nations, even upon my churches, and some of my sons and daughters. And I feel like a death of a baby inside of me. Yet I feel there's another baby that's alive, in which I know it is, that says, arise and shine, for the light has come, for the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. And I feel like we're in a season where there's death but life, where there's a pruning but yet there's a budding, fighting the good fight of faith. So we look at 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 12. And this is where we started to share a little bit on Wednesday, and I said, no, let's continue this next Wednesday. And here the father in the faith, Paul the apostle, is talking to his son Timothy. Paul had gone through things before. He was a veteran in the faith. He was experienced. And Timothy was a novice. He was a young man and a good man. I know he was a good man because he was a good son. Paul called him a faithful son, a loyal son, not just a church member or a congregant, but a loyal son. There's a big difference there. And he said, fight the good fight. Not any fight. Fight the good fight. And it's called the fight of faith. And lay a hold of eternal life, to which you were also called and have confessed the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. So here's where I get the title, not only of a sermon or a message, but your destiny. Fight the good fight of faith. Encounter Church, continue to fight. Because it's a good fight. It'll get you dirty. It will bruise you. It will hurt you. During the journey of the fight, you'll get discouraged. You'll feel lonely. Your emotions will be like a roller coaster. You'll have people in your life given to you, taken away from you. You'll be happy. You'll be sad. You'll be glad, you'll be mad, you'll go through a series of events and emotions in life, but yet the Bible calls it not only a fight, but a good fight. You'll cry, you'll suffer, you'll be afflicted, you'll be on the highest high and the lowest low. You feel like you can't do anything right. You may feel like you're in a good season where nothing's going wrong, but nonetheless, the father said to a son, Timothy, fight, Timothy. Don't quit, Timothy. Don't give up on her. Don't give up on him. Don't give up on them. Fight the fight, because in the end, you will realize it was a good fight. Bruised, beat, scarred, rejected, yet it's a good fight. And what makes it a good fight? Because God is by your side. What makes it a good fight? Because in the end, we win. But understand about this fight. Matthew 11, 12 says, I'm going to read just a portion. And the kingdom of heaven suffers of violence. And the violent, take it by force. Come on, I want you to scream, the violent.
Violence.
Come on, scream it.
Violence.
You got to get violent. If you're going to be in this fight, and a good fight, you got to get violent. Come on, scream violent.
Violent.
In the kingdom of heaven, not the kingdom of man, not the kingdom of darkness, the kingdom of heaven suffers violence. Come on, shout violence.
Violence.
Look at me. Look at me. And the violent. Feeling violent right now. And the violent! People are afraid to go to churches where people are violent. We're talking about a godly violence. And the violent! Don't just sit back and wait. The violent take it by force. Now, when it comes to giving and receiving, we don't take offerings, we receive. But there comes a time where you got to take. Go on, put that hand out like you mean it. Like your son's life was dependent upon it. Like your mother's, like your marriage was, like your last meal was dependent upon it. Hear me. Come on, put that hand out. Now squeeze that thing. Let it be a representation of your violence and your faith. Say, I'm going to take it. Shout by force.
By force.
When I'm in need, I don't need a God is good, God is great, let us thank him for our food. There's a time for that. When my back's against the wall, when all hell is breaking loose, I need some violent people around me. I need some contenders. Not pretenders. When your back's against the wall, you know those who are violent, that's got your back. Not a token prayer or a political pulpiteer pastoral blessing. Talking violence in your spirit, where the Spirit of God within you rises up and you say, enough is enough. Come on, shout, enough. Come on, scream it. I can't sit back in passivity. Let the devil take back what God already gave me and ask for it or reason or negotiate. We don't negotiate. We move in. We take back. We don't just hear it, we do it. We don't just say it, we practice it. The kingdom of heaven suffers violence. Now in Ephesians chapter 6, you've heard this before, starting with verse number 10. Finally, my brethren, I'm concluding now, he's saying, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Sounds like a strong veteran Christian to me. Sounds like somebody, whether young or older in the Lord, who knows what they're saying. Sounds like somebody to me that knows how to fight. Yes? Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his power and in his might. Verse 11. Put on the whole armor of God. Not a part. Put on the whole armor of God. Watch this. So that you will be able to stand against the wiles of the devil himself. Verse 12. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood. America right now is in a war against each other. Political sides, races. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against rulers of darkness and of this age. How many are glad that the Bible spells out who your real enemies are? Against rulers of darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places. That's why my wife and I, we're going to start doing more prayer walks, drive-bys in the Spirit praying. Verse 13, watch this. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God so that you may be able to withstand in the evil day. And having done all to stand, shout, stand. Shout, verse 14. Stand, again, new verse, repeats the word. Stand, therefore, having girded your waist with truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, 15, and having shod your feet with the preparation of gospel of peace, stay right there. We're seeing the artillery that God's given us to wear, correct? Yeah. All right, we see them all here, but now something interesting here takes place in verse 16 where something is standing out in the armor of God. Something's about to stand out. Are you ready?
Yeah.
16. Above all, shout above all.
Above.
Notice that. Taking the shield of faith, with which you will be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one. We're talking about fighting the good fight of faith. But right here, because the armor of God does not compete against itself, but it completes itself. But notice here, the apostle is careful to use these two words, above all. Come on, scream above all.
Above.
Yeah, you need to hear that. Taking the shield of faith. Fighting the good fight of faith. Now, what's so important about taking the shield of faith? What's so important about above all? Shout again, above all. See, many times we go to prayer, but we're not holding up the shield of faith. Hear me. Many times we do warfare. Warfare is a serious thing. You know, if you're doing warfare and your heart ain't right, or if your motives ain't right, you'll be the one that gets beat. I'll be the one that gets beat. Remember, I didn't come here to deliver a sermon. I came to deliver a warning, an exhortation, but most of all, comfort to these dear people, to you. A shield is a weapon used to protect during combat. Folks, we are in combat. Our church is in combat. Satan hates Encounter Church. We're in combat. Satan hates this ministry. He hates us. He hates the church down the street. He hates the church down the other side of the street. He hates the kingdom. A shield is a weapon to protect during combat, so that while you are at war, you yourself will not be a casualty. Taking hits? Yes. But taking hits by at first hitting the shield of faith. Some of you know I love baseball. I don't like baseball. I really like baseball a lot. And I have many baseball gloves. And many baseball gloves have great padding on them. But when you have somebody on the other side throwing you a ball 90 miles an hour and you're wearing a glove, Sometimes you can still feel the sting on the palm of your hand, even though you're holding up that mitt, that glove. So it is with the armor of God. When you hold up the shield of faith, it's a metaphor. It's not a real shield, as you know, but it's protection. Lord, the blood of Jesus over me. Lord, the name of Jesus over me. And the shield is something that gets hit, but the target is meant for you. The target is meant to hit you, your family, your marriage, your finances, your peace, your children, but God's given us faith as a shield so that it bounces off, it repels. And yes, you still feel the backlash, but the Lord paid the price so that he takes the hit. And many Christians are getting beat and bruised because they're praying. It's like playing baseball without a glove. Hockey without a stick. Basketball without gym shoes. He's given us the shield of faith, a weapon used to protect during combat. A shield bounces off. In other words, whatever the devil means for evil against you, the Lord says, don't worry, daughter. I'm just going to allow it to bounce off. Now, it has a sound to it like a ping or a bang. Don't let that sound scare you. Let it encourage you, knowing it may have come close. But yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. A shield is to ricochet off. A shield, get ready to shout on this one, a shield intercepts. See, many in the church, they're not allowing the shield to intercept. And that's why they get angry and mad and bitter and sore and quit and depressed and discouraged. To intercept. It's to block. Somebody say block.
Block.
A shield quenches the fiery darts of the enemy. But notice if we went back here a little bit into verse 13 and 14, it says, having done all to stand, stand. But that's so long as folks were holding the shield of faith. And then, of course, verse 17, the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. So when we speak the Word of God, we have to understand that as we speak, the devil gets angry. And as we speak, we have to use our faith as a shield and declaring, I'm declaring the Word. That I will be healed, I will be blessed. But that shield says, no weapon formed against me shall prosper. And every tongue that rises against me has to fall, for this is the heritage of the children of God. So we see here, folks, we have the shield of faith, the word of God to fight the good fight of faith, and to come against the fiery darts of the enemy. For our what? For our families. For our children. For our marriages. For our co-workers. For our friends, for our finances, for our church, for our churches. The war is real. What are these fiery darts for? My mind. My body, my health, dare I say, my sanity, your sanity. For what? For your emotions. What's the shield for? For your leaders. For me. For our schools, for your community, for your region, for your nation, for the nations. For one another. What are we fighting against? What are we fighting against? Because when you put on the armor, You're unclothing yourself of one and you're putting on something on of another. So today we stand here to some degree naked before God, which means honest. We use our faith to fight against discouragement. I've never in my 62 years of life seen more discouragement upon God's people than ever before. It's not just an encounter thing, counter church. It's churches. It's people. It's non-Christians. It's races. It's religions. Anyone and everyone on this earth, it seems like, are going through greater levels of discouragement. What's it against, these fiery darts? Why do we have the shield of faith? To fight against depression. Let me tell you something. There are people in this room today that you know what I'm talking about. I know what I'm talking about. Fighting discouragement. People fighting depression. Those thoughts of suicide, quitting, just giving up, fighting against, there's many, but God gave me a few today. He said, the ones I share today will be the heart, will be like the center, will be like the ground zero of really what people are fighting against the most. Discouragement, depression, loneliness. I know I'm speaking by the Spirit. Anxiety and rejection. And there's more. But this is the heart of the Epic Center. Discouragement. Depression. Loneliness. Anxiety. Rejection. Look at me again. Go like this. Come on. Come on, go like this. Force that thing out. Force that thing out. You won't break anything. Just force it out. Now make a tight fist. Say everything,
everything
that was just spoken out.
I resist it.
And I come against it.
With
the sword of the Spirit.
Which is the word of God.
Holding up
the shield of faith.
And right now.
My family,
my marriage,
my
finances,
my
mind,
my health,
my peace,
my
joy,
my strength,
my
happiness,
my
rest.
I take it back.
Because
we're fighting for.
I told you
who ours
and against.
Now for.
We're fighting
for our joy.
We're
fighting for
our joy.
We're
fighting to
keep our
marriage alive.
Fighting
to keep
churches
alive.
Nearly
10,000
churches will
close
in 1 year.
Shout,
not in this house.
Nearly
2,000
pastors every
month will quit
the ministry
in America
alone.
Come on, scream, not
in this house.
Not in this house.
Why?
Because
they're violent.
If
you ain't
violent,
look
out.
Because
somebody
else is
violent.
For
the thief
cometh
not but
to steal,
kill, and destroy.
But
I've got someone
who's even
more violent.
He's
from the lion
of the
tribe of
Judah.
Let
me tell
you something
about me.
I may
get sick
sometimes,
but I
don't accept
the
sickness.
I may
get down
sometimes,
but I'm not going
to accept
the
downness.
Because
so long
as there's
a will
in me,
God
in me
has given
me a will
to fight,
to
contend
for
the faith.
And
no matter
what I'm
going through,
I'm going
to go through
to
the other
side.
Mm.
It's not because how big I am. It's not because how strong I am. Because first of all, I'm not big. Second of all, I'm not strong. Because the Bible says, let the weak say they are strong. So when I'm weakest, when I'm weakest, I'm at my greatest strength. When I'm at my weakest is when my God can show up and say, Jimmy, Jimmy, Jimmy. Let my strength take over for yours. When you don't want to come back and face the people, I'll grab you by the hand, son. I won't force you back, but the force of faith will be in you and say, just make it another hour. Make it another day. And you will see, you made it another week. You made it another month. I am here to declare to Encounter Church, to you, the people, you made it another day. Doesn't matter what happened yesterday. You've got the scars. You've got the bruises. You've been taken down. You've been taken down. Hear me. You've been taken down. Hear me. You've been taken down. Hear me. You've been taken down, but you have not been taken out. You've been taken down, but you've not been taken out. Voices have taken me down. People have taken me down. Money has taken me down. Thoughts have taken me down, but it's not taken me out. Because I insist. In the natural, you can call me a stubborn New York Italian if you want to see me that way. But in the spirit, like a David. In the spirit, like a Shadrach, like a Meshach, like an Abednego, like a Daniel, like a Nehemiah, like a Paul. Oh my God, I feel his glory in this house. I'm here to tell you that the rest of you, hear me. I didn't come to entertain you. This is life. I was there in the spirit when the doctor told you you had cancer. I was there in the spirit when your daughter hung herself at 12 years old. I was there in the spirit when your son fell out of a tree and nearly broke his head open. I was there in the spirit when your husband committed adultery on you. I was there in the spirit when you carried that baby full term only to lose it in the end. I was there in the spirit. I know what I'm talking about. I was there in the spirit when you thought your breakthrough came and the last second it seemed like it did not. I was there in the spirit when it's 3 o'clock in the morning and you still can't sleep. No, I'm not your great intercessor, he is. But I am a shepherd boy filled with faith, with passion. That if this is my last breath, I'm going to be certain it's my greatest breath. It'll be my best breath. It'll be my strongest breath. Because though we're perplexed, crushed on every side, yea, we are more than conquerors through Christ. I know what it's like. I know what it's like to lose family. I know what it's like to lose a mama. I know what it's like to lose a daddy. I know what it's like to lose a wife. I know what it's like to lose a baby. But yea, in all these things, we are more than conquerors. You got to hold up the shield of faith. You got to contend for the faith. Because you are winners. No matter what you feel like now, you're winners. You're winners. You're winners. Let me tell you something, kids, and I mean this as a papa. Now sit if you could, if you want to stand, I'm not going to tell you. Listen to me. You're more than just mamas. You're more than just papas. You're more than just a ladies' group that gets together and plays Uno and cards. And I love to hear about these things. I love community. I love when sisters in the Lord get together. Man, it's more than about coming to church and pulling some weeds on a Saturday morning. Guys, it's more than singing 3-4 songs on a Sunday morning. It's more than playing an instrument, and it's more than preaching. It's the character of our God that resides within us. It says, not by might, not by power, but by my Spirit, says the Lord. There are things in your life that you've not shared with anybody. Those of you watching, there are things in your life that you've shared with nobody. Some, maybe it's shame, I don't know. For some, perhaps it's, I don't want to burden you. You already have enough going on in your world. I don't know. But your Father sees everything. He sees the struggles. He sees the warfare. He sees the temptations. It's easy to blame somebody for what he did, what she did, but you know the temptation that took place moments before. The warfare, the anguish. In Jude chapter 3, I got to close. There's only one chapter in Jude, so you can call it chapter 1, verse 3, or just verse 3. But the precious, beloved brother Jude, he had some things to say. Beloved, while I was very diligent. That's a warrior. You know somebody who's a warrior if they're very diligent. Very diligent to write to you concerning, he had some concerns, our common salvation. Folks, I've got good news for you today. We're in this thing together. And we're going to win this thing together. From Texas to Ohio, we're going to win this thing together. I found it necessary, kind of like me sometimes, I got to change my message around to fit what God's doing that moment. I found it necessary to write to you, exhorting you to contend earnestly for the faith which was once for all delivered to the saints. In other words, I preached this thing to you before. I thought you got it by now. And Paul says, it's okay. It's not, but we'll make it okay. He says, I'm coming back. I'm going to tell you this again. Encounter church. Church in America. Church around the world. Church in Texas. Church in Ohio. Everywhere. I'm telling you again. Earnestly contend for the faith. Now, to keep this in proper context, we're not going to go there, but Paul, Jude was talking about Christians who are now preaching false gospels, just like today. But we're not going to emphasize false gospels. We're going to emphasize the true gospel. And Paul says, contend for the faith. Earnestly contend for the faith. Listen to this. To contend means, hear me, to hold nothing back. Hear me. Because this is my story. This is your story. To hold nothing back, even if you feel like you are struggling. To hold nothing back, even when you're exhausted, tired, discouraged, rejected, depleted, struggling, to contend. Is to fight strenuously with all your might. A contender, like I said earlier, is not a pretender. Jude is warning, exhorting, encouraging. Contend. Fight. You feel like quitting? Yes, you do. We all do sometimes, but fight. Folks, it's time to fight for our churches. It's time to fight for our pastors. It's time to fight for our missionaries. It's time to fight for each other. Fight for our children. Fight for our nation. That I would sure like to again one day call it the United States of America. Rather than divided, fight. More than vote, fight. Fight for this region. Fight for Jim DePalma. Fight for Joni DePalma. Fight for our widows. Fight for those in hospitals and prisons. Fight for those that protect us. Fight for those who are being bloodied on the streets. Fight, fight, fight. Knowing that your fight is not in vain. Knowing that the Holy Spirit within you is the real fighter. And you're the vessel that's being used. Contend for the faith. If there's ever a time to contend for our marriage, our children, our family, our finances, our churches, our minds, our health, to contend, it's now. Come on, shout now.
Now.
I like what Paul said in 2 Timothy 4:7. We're not there yet. Say, we're not there yet. Because we're still in the process. I have fought the good fight. It's a good fight, folks. The battles aren't always good, but in the end, it's a good fight. When two boxers go at each other and beat the snot out of each other, and they're all bloodied up and black-eyed, one comes out a winner. Folks, you're the winner. I said you're the winner. But when you hold up the shield of faith, when you hold up the shield of faith, you're protected. Your eyes won't have to bleed. Your nose doesn't have to be broken. Your teeth do not have to pop out because he's given you faith to overcome the world, which makes you a world overcomer. Jesus said, in Luke 18:8, when the Son of Man returns, will he find faith on earth? Talking to the church as well. Folks, it's time to pick up again the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. How do I fight? In prayer. How do I fight? In confession. How do I fight? Not against warriors, but with warriors. How do I fight? Showing up. How do I fight? Building community. How do I fight? Renewing my mind. Will he find faith on earth? I believe he has to. Because Hebrews 11:6 says, for without faith, it's impossible to please him. For he who comes to God must believe that he is. And he is a rewarder of those who diligently, come on out loud, diligently. Seek him. Not seek the other person, not seek vengeance, but seek him. You know, I know we've heard this for years, we've chuckled, but Rocky had it right when he said, I don't go down for nobody. Those who diligently seek him. Jesus said to Peter, and Jesus is saying to us, and you'll find this, you can just take a note on it if you'd like. We'll see it on the screen. But Jesus said to Peter, and is saying to Encounter Church, in Luke 22:31-32, he said, Satan has come, and he's asked that he may sift you as wheat. Notice here, the devil cannot do anything without God's protection. But we have to do some protection of our own, and that is holding up the sword of the Spirit and the shield of faith. But here's what Jesus said. He didn't get down on him. He didn't blast him. Here's what he said in the next verse. But I've prayed for you that your faith should fail not. And when you have returned to me, strengthen your brother. And God is saying to his church this morning in the calendar, he's saying to his churches today, body of Christ, I'm grieved at what I see in your world, even in your churches sometimes. But I've got your back. And I'm praying for you. And I'm praying that you will not let go of the sword of the Spirit. Jesus is praying that we will not let go of the shield of faith, which will extinguish all the fiery darts of the evil one. And then Jesus went on to say, so that you can go back and strengthen your brothers. We're in this thing together. We're one big church in this region, in this nation. Ones that have called out, we've been hit. America's been hit. The church has been hit. Churches are hit. Marriages are hit. Families are hit. Pastors are hit. Finances are hit. But when we've done all to stand, but it gets tiring. Trust me. I've been doing this a long time. I know what tire is. But I've been rejected. But he was rejected. Despised by man and acquainted with grief and sorrows, yet he was wounded for our transgressions and bruised for our iniquities. And the chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by, section one, by his stripes, section two, his stripes, you are healed physically, emotionally, spiritually, physically, in our minds, in our hearts. We've been crushed, but not forsaken. Bruised, but not let down. For his church will triumph. His church will win. His church will stand. And today I give birth to a dead baby. And I put it on the altar. And I say, dead baby, Holy Spirit, breathe and speak to these dry bones of the dead baby. And I declare that dead baby to live again. I declare the dead babies of our families, of our dreams, the dead hopes, the lack of peace, the lack of joy, even the lack of happiness. Yes, I'm throwing that in there. The lack of finances. The lack of strength. I declare to that dead baby, live and rise. For every Ephraim needs a Manasseh. And every Manasseh needs an Ephraim. And may they crisscross together. And may we cross-pollinate in this house to where we are one. Because you're more than just a bunch of women getting together. You're more than just a bunch of men getting together And that's good, and I'm so proud of you, and I endorse it. But how good and pleasant it is for brothers to dwell together in unity. What is playing a game, telling a joke? It's good. It's good. But coming together as the bride of Christ. And as my daughter was preparing her wedding, my wife and I were preparing her wedding, I could think about the Lord preparing for his church, the bride and the groom. And people of God, he's coming back for a glorious church that's been restored, healed, and have the scars to prove it. But the scars no longer hurt. They're just a reminder of where we've come from and where we've been and where we are and where we're going. This has been the word of the Lord.